Hello students, in this lesson let us study about the air traffic control aids. So the air traffic control aids are basically divided into two categories. The first one is the en route aid or airway aids, and the second one is the landing aids or the terminal aids. So in this lesson we will majorly be studying about the en route or airway aids. So to get started with, an appropriate and effective positive aid is very much required for the control of air traffic. Now we can divide these aids into number of ways. For instance, we can divide them into your external aid and internal aid. So external is the one which is located on the, say, ground, and internal is the one which is located in the cockpit of your aircraft. Right? This is on the cockpit of the aircraft and this is on the ground. So this is one instance of classification of air traffic control aids. The other instance may be on the category of flying over oceans, right? Only during the flight of the aircrafts on the ocean we use these aids, and the other instance is when you are flying on the ground or the land, right? Based on this also you can categorize. So for easier purpose, mainly the air traffic control aids are divided into two categories, as I initially mentioned. The first one is the en route aids or the airway aids, and the second one is the landing aids, or we can also call them as terminal aids. So in this lesson we will study everything about en route or airway aids, and in the next coming lesson we will study about the landing or the terminal aids. So to deal with the en route aids or the airway aids, these are all the en route aids we have. So the first one is your air route surveillance radar, the second one is air to ground communication, third one is the airway beacon, fourth one is the direction finder, fifth one is the distance measuring equipment, sixth one is the low or medium frequency range radio, seventh one is your marker beacon, eighth one is your tactical air navigation, and the last one is your very high frequency omnidirectional ranger. Now we will study in detail each one of these aids. So the air route surveillance radar are nothing but these are your long range radars which are installed along the airway to keep a watch on your aircraft. So in this particular thing, the abbreviation of the term radar is nothing but radio detection and ranging. So what this control will do is it will get the picture of each aircraft on the radar screen, and the operator will be able to decide the exact position of the aircraft. So the effective range of this radar is about 200 kilometers. So actually, if you speak in a very strict sense, these radars are not aid to the air navigation, because its principal function is to provide the air traffic controller with a visual display, right? It will provide you a visual display of the position of each aircraft so that they can monitor their spacing and intervene whenever or wherever it is necessary. So however, the radar can be used by the air traffic controller to guide the aircraft whenever it is necessary for the purpose of the safety. So that's why we can include these type of radars in the list of the en route aids. Okay, next one is the air to ground communication. So all the flight instructions and the relevant data will be conveyed to the pilot from the ground. So the pilot who is in the aircraft, for him it will be conveyed from the ground along the entire length of this airway, right? So this communication will be sent by either FSS or by your ARTCC. The next one is the air beacon. So in the past, the airway beacons were placed at a distance of about 40 kilometers along the length or the along the airway run from one airport to another airport, so that it can provide a guidance to the pilot. So however, the air beacons are superseded at the present by better and more effective navigational aids. So they have replaced it. Initially, they were of very much use. And nowadays, you can see them only in certain locations like your hill peaks, etc. You can see these particular type of en route aids or the airway aids. So the next one is the direction finder. So there are two types of direction finder. The first one is your automatic direction finder, and the second one is the radio direction finder. So as the name itself is indicating that it is automatic. This is normally made up of modern and sophisticated equipments which will keep the antenna pointed towards the point of transmission, and there is no need of any adjustment in order to get the direction to this particular instrument, right? Whereas in case of radio direction finder, the pilot has to rotate the RDF. RDF is nothing but radio direction finder. So this is nothing but ADF, automatic direction finder. So the pilot has to rotate the RDF to find the direction with respect to the transmitter. Suppose you get a very high pitch tone, then it means that you are in the direction of the station, right? Suppose you get a blank or a null space, blank or null space or sound, then it means that you are at right angle to the direction of the station. So that is how you will be able to find out the direction with the help of your radio direction finder, RDF. The next one is the distance measuring equipment. So you can see in this figure, through waves, the distance is being measured. So these are also called as DME, the short form for this. They are installed at nearly all the VOR. So at all VOR stations, you need to install these distance measuring equipments. So it normally indicates or gives the pilot the distance, air distance between the aircraft and a particular VOR station. And the pilot will be able to gauge his exact position by knowing the bearing with respect to your airway. Okay, so this is how the distance measuring equipment will help you for the en route aid. Next one is your low bar medium frequency radio range. So they are also called as LF, low frequency, and MF, medium frequency. So in early 30s, these were invented, and they totally changed the or gave a revolution to your navigational aid. So here normally you have four cores radio range. So this sends out four radio beam along four directions. So four radio beams are sent along four directions, which may or may not be at right angle to each other. So it's not particular that they have to be at right angle. They can be at any angle to each other. So this facility may be located near the airport, or if a pilot is able to pick up a steady tone, it indicates the correctness of the air route followed by him. If, however, the pilot is not on the correct route, he will hear a dash and dot or a dot and dash signal, and he has to adjust his position accordingly. But this type of radio signals has disadvantage also, because the pilot initially has to know where exactly the transmission station is with respect to him. Otherwise, he has to fly over a very complicated route, and may repeatedly attempt to achieve the goal, right? And the second one is that there will be difficulty for the static interference with this particular method. And during bad weather, this is not at all possible, especially like your thunderstorms. Understood. So the next one is your marker beacon. So your marker beacon are nothing but small radio transmitters. So these will normally help the pilot to know what is their exact position with respect to a given airway. So what these beacons will do is they will send coded signals, coded radio signals, which the pilot will be able to identify. Okay. Normally, just above the radio range station, there will be a cone, or this is also called as cone of silence. It is formed by inverting a cone with a limited area. As the aircraft enters the cone, the signal abruptly fades out and they remain black for a few seconds until the aircraft is in the cone area. So, and this will once again start as soon as the aircraft leaves the cone area or goes out of the cone area. So the duration of marker indicates increase with the increase in the flight altitude. Okay, so this is about your marker beacon. The next one is your tractional air navigation. Now, in order to satisfy the tractational is nothing but also called as your maneuvering requirements of your military forces, and en route air navigation aid was developed by the US Navy in the early 50s. So that is nothing but your tactational air navigation. So we can write this TAT as capital. The abbreviation for this is TACAN, TACAN. So what will this TACAN do is it will measure the azimuth. Azimuth is nothing but the north direction, right? And also this will measure the distance in one unit instead of two units. And these TACANs are usually operated using the ultra high frequency bands. Moving on to the last one, it is the very high frequency omnidirectional ranger. So you can see in this figure, this is how they will look. So this is the most common one. Most common ground system which is used for finding the bearing. So this is generally abbreviated as VHF Omni Range, or we can call it as VOR. So this is a general name for your very high frequency omnidirection ranger. So what this VOR station will do is it will send out the radio signals in all the directions. So if you observe, there is a possibility of sending out signals in all 360 degree directions. Now we can consider each degree or each station as a course or a route referred to as a radial that can be followed by an aircraft. So totally you will have how many courses? 360 courses or routes that can be directed from your VOR, and each route is at 1 degree interval. Normally the magnetic north will indicate the 0 degree bearing, and this bearing will go up to 360 degree in clockwise direction. Normally this VOR is kept in a small square building station on an unobserved hilltop or in open fields or on other exposed grounds, and all these are not interfered with your static interference, and even during thunderstorm they will remain very, very effective. The range of the VOR stations varies very widely, but it should be less than 370 kilometers. The VOR receiver in the cockpit has a dial for turning in the desired VOR frequency. So the pilot can select the VOR radial or route they wish to follow to the VOR station. Then the position deviation indicator in the cockpit will indicate the heading of the aircraft relative to the direction of the desired radial, and it also shows whether the aircraft is in the right or left of the radial. Generally, these VOR stations will have full tech and equipment. So both azimuth as well as direction measuring equipments can be installed there. So that type of stations are called as VOR TECAN. Okay, the combination of these two navigational aids will become VOR TECAN. So these are some of the en route aids or your airway aids. And the best one is the VOR en route aid. Hope this lesson is clear to you now.